ladies and gentlemen, councillors, to the Environment Review and Scrutiny Committee. The first item on the agenda is apologies for absence. I've got Councillor Christine Musgrave, Councillor Irene Williams, Councillor Chris Blakely, and Councillor Andrew Hodgson. Are there any other apologies? We've got various deputies and all the name tags of them. Members, are there any declarations of interest or party with me? Okay, before I go to the minutes, the Director of Governance and Assurance had to look at wants to add a few words about the pre-election gathering.
Members, if anyone was here at last night's overview scrutiny, you've got the same talk from the Chair, which is that obviously we are in the pre-election period, so the Council has to be careful of how it publicises information that includes spoke past this evening. So, whilst obviously the scrutiny will not normally make overtly political comments, the Chair will intervene if those comments are made and remind members and possibly remind members again if necessary not to make such comments, and as said previously, if there are any particularly controversial issues that will take you into that area in respect of the general election, then it's within the committee's ability to adjourn until after.
Thank you for that. Minutes, we need to approve the action minutes and over. David Elton wants to make a few comments on that.
Just two comments, Chair. The first one is you did ask at the last meeting for a briefing note about the garden waste subscription service. You should have had that, it has been circulated. So I hope that meets that requirement. And secondly, a member of the public rightly took issue with me because they watched the committee on the council system. And the word storms used in the Hill Island presentation. I knew I'd corrected it at the meeting, but it wasn't in the presentation. I went back to the residents and said it was corrected in the meeting. It was on Mr. Race's video and it was on the council's video that there wasn't a storm, there were some heavy seas that washed things out. But because the resident took the trouble to write and I went back, I just wanted to reconfirm that there wasn't a storm. It was just some heavy seas. Just to update you on that, we've had no complaints in recent weeks about anything on the island. I met again with the defence group and various things are in train. Myself and a colleague are going to Preston next Wednesday to the National Maritime Organisation to be interviewed about the incident and give an account of what we've done since. That's what it's up to.
Thank you. And with those comments, can we agree the minutes of last meeting?
Very briefly, I'll just highlight the key aspects of this report, if I may. The report sets out the financial monitoring position for the overview for the environment overview and scrutiny committee as at quarter two for this financial year, for both revenue and capital budgets. The first part of the report, section 3.1, covers the capital budgets. Table 1 shows our projected planned capital expenditure has evolved since the budgets were approved back in March. There's been a significant reduction in the planned capital expenditure for the year, down from £64 million to £32 million. The reasons of which are detailed in the report, but in particular, delays in reprofiling the acquisition of regeneration sites and the implementation of the community bank. While spend on the LED street lighting project and West Kirby Flood Defence have also been reprofiled to reflect greater expenditure in the next financial year 2021. The second part of the report in section 3.2 covers the revenue budgets and shows that across the delivery and economic and housing growth directorates, there's a projected adverse variance of approximately £2.5 million. The budget pressure sits mainly within the Delivery Services Directorate, with the main pressures being detailed in sections 3.2.6 and 7, and they come from shortfalls in income for sports and recreation, car parking, garden waste and environmental enforcement, all of which were highlighted in the quarter one report. There's also a pressure of £500,000 for delays in implementation of the floor pavilion approved budget savings option, and we are now also forecasting a variance from increasing demand on the home to school transport service. Officers continue to work to mitigate these pressures before the end of the year, but as a quarter two, these are the expected variances. That's a very brief summary of the report.
David said when he commented on the minutes, you received the note which responded to the questions that you posed at the meeting in September. So I suppose the key thing that's set out in the note you received is that in the 18-19 previous financial year, garden waste service was set a very ambitious target of around £300,000 additional income. Now, what we're projecting by the end of this year, 1920, is that we'll be around £120,000 adrift from that £300,000 target. So, despite the fact that we increased the subscription fee to £43 this year, and a very slow start due to issues it set out in the notes, we are at the same levels that we've been in previous years. So, since the subscription was introduced in 2013, apart from the first and maybe second year, we've tended to attract around 40,000 subscribers, and that's the case for this year. So with the increased subscription and the sort of marketing activities that have occurred, we haven't made the £300,000 target, but we are making progress with it. So we think by March next year we'll be around £120,000 short of that £300,000 projection, which was an ambitious target. Exact numbers of take up in terms of those who utilise the offer to hand, but I can give you that information. I'm not sure whether that's actually driven much increase in subscription. It's additional service that subscribers can enjoy, but it's not actually been the incentive in terms of driving numbers. That's not achieved that at this moment.
Any more questions?
The question mentioned in the report about the termination of the council's contract with the kingdom. That's produced a shortfall. Not going to bother about the actual shortfall because we're still getting a lot of complaints with regards to the environmental breaches that we have. So the dog farm and the litter and the other breaches to the environment. So I'm just wondering, what are you putting in place? What options have you looked at and what are you going to actually do about it? Because it's not going away.
Chair, I'm mindful obviously of comments made by Phil earlier. there was a deficit created by the decision we took to terminate the Kingdom contract. I think the next item is the corporate enforcement policy, which I think Mark is going to update you on. So the corporate enforcement policy, which includes environmental enforcement, it will be the overview of that. But our idea is that the enforcement isn't taking place at the moment as it did before in our Kingdom, and that we're taking time to determine the way forward for enforcement in the future.
Thank you. Thank you. Got the next agenda item on the paper. So, any more questions? No? Okay. Thank you. We can move on to the enforcement policy, the Council's enforcement policy, by Mark Campbell.
Thank you, Chair. Just to introduce the members who haven't met, Bas Campbell, who's our senior environmental manager, has come as well. One to observe, and obviously it'll be his team that primarily is involved about this enforcement policy. So if there's any technical questions that come through at the end, thank you, Chair, for those. Chair, again, just the reports in front of all members have been circulated. This is a regular item, really, in terms of when there are changes to the single enforcement policy. We come to scrutiny to get views and comments to see whether we've got that right or whether we need to make any changes to those. In terms of the report itself, the enforcement policy was an attempt a number of years ago to bring a whole range of individual enforcement policies which were service specific into one combined policy, which therefore gives the customers who are operating in Wirral and also officers who are out there a single framework to operate under in terms of guide enforcement. There are, however, a couple of exclusions to that which I'm obviously to make this committee aware of. They're primarily around safeguarding both adults and children, because they'll operate within their own frameworks, and also parking enforcement isn't covered within this specifically, because again, the parking enforcement side has very clear national criteria to operate under. In terms of the report itself, Mike's made a view before in terms of the recommendation. One of the primary reasons bringing it here was the decision to for Kingdom to remove the Kingdom side of it, and that meant we need to change this, moving away from that robust enforcement zero tolerance approach, which I know members across all parties were concerned about, to something that's a bit more of an emollient and subjective approach, really, in terms of enforcement. In terms of the actual way that's going to take forward, we're still working up that model in terms of what that looks like, which again Mike's referred to, but it's likely to be some sort of in-house provision within our existing enforcement people as we go forward. But the detail of that will come when we work that model up in effect. The enforcement policy itself is required by the regulator's code to publish our enforcement policy. In 3.2 of the report, you'll see the areas that it covers there. Another in addition to this is the safety in sports ground. So again, the council has a statutory obligation to issue a safety certificate to sports grounds that meet the criteria. For Wirral, that's Prenton Park. So in terms of this, we have a requirement of the enforcement policy to cover the activity about issuing a safety certificate to that sports ground. And I'm sure those who follow the news will know how important that is, given the court case that's going on around Hillsborough. Engagement and consultation. We engaged across all council service areas, and we also, for the first time with this enforcement policy, we went out to a public consultation online. And in 8.2, whilst I'm disappointed that only 7 people chose to respond to that consultation, I think that was rather important and right to do that. So in terms of the report itself, it's there in front. The recommendations for the committee to note and comment as required, and any comments that come back that have a material effect on the way that the enforcement policy is written, we'll obviously consider those going in, but ultimately, if there are none, we're looking to take this to Cabinet as the next available opportunity to get signed off in place. Happy to answer any questions, Chair.
Okay. The recommendation is that the committee note the comments as required and update the Wirral Council enforcement policy kept contained within the appendix.
policy itself with no comments from this committee.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Item agenda 5, notice they've been referred on notice of motion, mergers and pollinators. We have contemplated to present before. Thank you.
Good evening, members. Thank you very much. To assist me tonight and to perhaps help members answer any questions, I've brought Mary Wirral, who's our senior manager for parks. She has a specialist knowledge in this area. And Steve Henderson, who's our operational manager, who manages the verges and things. So hopefully if there's any questions afterwards, between us, we'll be able to answer them. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present this report. It's in response to a notice of motion from July 2019 in respect of verges and pollinators. The members asked officers to research the Rotherham model, which for some years on their main road, they've been planting native wildflowers, and you asked us to see if we could create a future scheme that we set up in Wirral. In terms of our kind of research, what we put in the report is the detail of the potential costs of introducing such a trial in Wirral, where any potential suitable sites could be located, and how we could consult on identifying further areas. The report outlines 8 potential sites, and we propose that there should be 2 trial sites, one at Leavers Causeway and one at the junction of Plymyard Avenue and Eastern Road. The trial of these sites, the report suggests that success can be measured by the how overall we establish on top of these pollinated plants established, how the biodiversity would develop in these areas, the visual impact, and the reception from residents, taking into consideration cost and value. The trial for these 2 sites would cost £952.80 using the methodology we described in 4.5. And we would likely report that there's going to be some positive benefits in these trial areas if it establishes as we have planned, offering a habitat food source for pollinating insects and wildlife, and more widely spread may result in less expenditure on fossil fuel if we had to be less net emitters. I hope that's okay as an instruction, Chair, and we'll see if I have any questions. Thank you.
I'll speak to someone who seems to know a little bit about pollinators, and they said that there are some wildflowers which basically help reduce weeds. Now, I don't know much about that, but if that is the case, it'd be useful to have that in the mix.
Thank you, Chair. Could you just describe to me, I'm interested in the cut. So when the grass is cut, if you don't cut it at a certain time, you can produce more pollinators. Could you go through that for me?
Yeah, so what we're proposing at Leavers
causeway links into that. So I would probably use the word on benefits. Most people would probably use the word cow parsley, but there's technically there's lots of different benefits. Some of them call cow parsley, some of them call other things. But the plants which grow up and in the summer look white and fluffy and like umbrellas and feathers. So Liga's Causeway has got lots of those and they look really, really lovely. And from a pollinator or insect point of view, those umbrellas and flowers are really good for lots of small insects, some of which have good pollinators and other ones have got benefits in their own rights. And the proposal is, what we've actually agreed with the Rights of Way officer, is although he's been asking us to cut them down from a sightline point of view, when the details are being looked through, actually such an approach is not so necessary. So we'll be able to leave those umbellas up while they're flowering, which one will look lovely, fantastic, but also will benefit pollinators and insects.
Thank you. Helen?
Just looking at the roads that you've chosen, I appreciate it's a trial and you've got some areas, but there's so much extensive work taking place on the A41. I didn't quite understand why the A41 wouldn't present itself as the first place to do it. And then also, I don't understand about the M53 and how we could or couldn't do something there, because in the bottom it was their ring road. And so, although some of these may well be suitable following trial, or maybe not be rolled out, it's just the prioritisation I didn't quite understand.
So, yeah, the bypass works, we talked to Sean in Highways, and he says rather than it be regrassed, yes, we could have a wildflower mix, and he's looking at the prices of that. So, in addition to the suggested pilot on the edges of roads with flat grass already, that one's in the pipeline as well. Motorways are slightly more complicated. We can talk to the Highway Authority and the people responsible for motorways and see if they're up for that. I do know somebody who has been involved in those sorts of schemes on the motorway network. That's something that we can explore to.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Through you. Can I just be clear in my mind, apart from the positive environmental advantages of this, are we saying that overall it will actually save money for the council because it will be less cost in cutting grass, etc., etc.? So overall, we will be saving money as well.
Thank you. The Rotherham scheme identified that the way that they maintained it costs less money if you look at it on a sort of two-yearly basis. Basically, the thing to be aware of with wildflower planting schemes, I'm going to be technical again, many of the flowers that look really beautiful and are used on these planting schemes, such as at Olympic Park, such as at Rotherham, a lot of them are what would be called ruderals. So ruderals is a technical term for the plants that grow in tilled soils. So poppies is a classic example of that. So in order for poppies to seed, the soil has to be turned over. If you just leave it, it starts off being full of those sorts of flowers, and over time they fade away and grasses take over, etc. So in Rotherham, they've got a scheme where they sort of regenerated in effect on a two-yearly basis. But that approach they found for their stretch saved them £23,000 compared to a mowing regime over the same area. So it depends what's done where, but yeah, there's potential to measure something that would cost less if big forage schemes were done once you've got them in that state. But what we've flagged up is that you have to get rid of the grass first. Now, traditionally, ironically, that would have been done by killing grass with glyphosate. We're proposing that we actually do it by taking the turf off, take the grass away, and then seed into that. If it's another technical thing to be aware of, there's a lot of wildflowers like very low nutrient.
A couple of comments, Chair. Obviously, the motorways and the highways agency, we don't have any powers to dictate what happens there. We do talk to them regularly about things. We're talking to them again at the moment about bridges and bridge safety and bridge fencing. We can pass the comments on. They do a lot less cutting than we used to on the side of the motorways. They tend to just clear sidelines to signs where they used to trim whole banks. I think the A41 is a nice example where there is a practical benefit, as was mentioned there by Councillor Kenny. If you look at the A41 Gorkery bypass, we've taken out the central rope reservation barrier that used to attempt to stop a vehicle going through and replaced it with a traditional crash barrier. We've also put a lot more crash barrier on the other side of the lane, which will make it harder for Steve's people to cut the grass if we left it as it is, because we've introduced crash barrier down the inside lane as well as the middle for safety reasons. Clearly you can't then just mow it, so actually planting this type of kind of material behind it is helpful. It saves somebody, saves a gang of people having to close the lanes and streams, which can take a long time. So there are practical benefits as well, yeah. And hopefully we've also added a lot of conduit there for future use, which is currently empty, so hopefully that will be the A41 sorted for quite some time. New surface, new crash barrier, conduits put in place to future-proof any cable that needs to go in, ours or anybody else's. And I hope we can do this ceiling as well. That should really quite new lighting as well. That should sort it out for a considerable time.
Okay, thank you. So the recommendation is that members note and consider the contents of the report to provide guidance on future work regarding the pollinator purchase. So, any further guidance? Is that agreed? Okay, next item on the agenda is the Marine Lake Management. We've got Colin Clayton and Neil Thomas to introduce us to the report. In terms of the report presenting tonight, I aim to inform members of the environmental and civil engineering issues which are affecting the water and sea wall of West Derby Marine Lake. The current issues affecting the Marine Lake, we have what we believe is an invasive seaweed called Sargassum ruticum, which rapidly grows in May to June. This forms very large rafts on the surface of the piles and rubbers. It's also been observed to anchor into the boundary wall of the lake, which is thought to lead to the degradation. The second interrelated issue is the accumulation of silt on the lake bed, causing ground and craft where the water is not is too shallow. Within the report, we've outlined the complexities associated with considering what work to be undertaken, given the local ecology, the estuary regulations, and the various permissions that would need to be sought before we could undertake any work on this area. In light of these complexities, we propose three potential options for members to consider. There's the do nothing and we'll kind of struggle on where we are at the moment with some of the difficulties and complaints we're getting. Give consideration to whether we should undertake the minimum work. I think within the report we've alluded to whether that minimum work was already done in 2009. Or we pursue the option of engaging a specialist contractor to advise on the marine ecology and civil engineering issues. Over the last couple of months, the three of us have spent a bit of time trying to find the right company and do some soft market testing. Even the discussions were quite complex in trying to find out what they asked for us from them. We've identified a couple of companies in the last couple of days, and maybe more than we've identified, but the cost of doing the project management and consultancy to advise us on how we should comply and what order we should do is in the order of £40,000 to £47,000. That's the kind of market rate we've kind of tested. Within the report, we've highlighted hopefully the risks to members with the options and other members can be aware of the legal risks as well as the potential economic impact on the activities which are numerous to make. I hope that's okay. Thank you. Thanks, Colin. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Chair. I'd just like to express a a slight disappointment. I actually raised the issue of the silting and the weed in the lake 6 months ago, and reading Colin's report, it says they still haven't definitively identified the weed in question. It does seem 6 months is a long time not to find out the answer of what it is, because once we know that, that determines what the next course of action might be. So, in so many cases, our council appears to be slow to respond to issues. I presume at this stage, obviously, if we went for the consultant option, £40,000 to £47,000, that seems sensible to me. But would we have any idea that the sort of sum that we might be involved if we have to go for the dredging and clearing of the lake? I mean, what sort of figure might we be looking at?
So in terms of costs, it depends on the management action that comes out of that operation by a consultant. A lot of the costs will be associated with disposal of the sand from the Greaney lake. In the past, we've been able to dispose of that on the foreshore, which is a relatively short distance and easy to do at a lower cost. The sort of advice we've received at the moment is that that's unlikely to be consented again by the regulatory authorities, so we'll be looking at disposal off-site. There's a lot of sand in the Greaney lake at the moment, well in excess of 20,000 cubic metres. So we think that the costs could be in the region of £500,000 up to £1 million.
Just a comment. It may feel slow, and perhaps we could have tackled that as an individual item. I think what we were facing is, as we sat down as a group, probably quite a long list of which regulators, which to do, where do we start. I think what we didn't want to do is start going off until we had a very clear kind of plan, and perhaps even if we did identify it, there wasn't much we were going to do about it as an individual until we got the overall advice. But take on point, 6 months is too slow, and we've probably been working on this quite intensely for about 3 months, so it probably took us 3 months, so I apologise for that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any further questions? Jane?
In relation to timing, obviously there are a lot of things that happen on Marine Lake, like the Wilson Trophy, for instance, international team racing and such like. But for those to continue, we've got to have a lake that is accessible and useful for those actual events. And it seems to me the longer you leave the lake in the state it is, the worse it's going to get. So what's your idea on potential timings that we take on this consultancy project? What's your hope that we actually move towards completion?
Mike Worthy. I liaise with the Sailing Club on a very regular basis, let them know what's going on. The weed itself has a life cycle, and we've discovered May and June are the times that it really grows, but then it dies back again. The time scales on all of this process from the soft market testing would indicate that we're not likely to deal with it until possibly autumn 2020. The Sailing Club are aware of it, but it equally affects the sailing centre at our end as well. It is a difficult one, this one. It takes a long time to work out, especially with all the permissions in the Dee estuary. It's quite complicated, I think, and my understanding is that, we're not the experts here with this one, and it's taken a bit of time to actually get some traction, to find people who are able to assist. There's plenty of sort of anecdotal work that has gone on, I'll say including Wikipedia, but this isn't the right forum, that isn't the right forum for a weed of this nature. My understanding is where you've got the dry land of that Japanese knotweed, this is the wet version, as it were. But that's me almost talking as a layman here, so we've got to get this right. I think the eyes of Wirral community or on that marine lake, so it isn't something we could rush into. trying to find a home with people who can give us the right answers to it. There's, you know, we can all dive into Wikipedia, but that is not the answer for us in this case. We've got to get it right. So apologies for the delay. We'll move forward correctly with it.
Yeah,
carry on. Thank you, Mike. Just to come back on that there. In the recommendation, Mayor suggested about 8.2 that we include the six councillors who are going to be first subordinated in Mel's ward in the consultation, and then we are part of that engagement plan, if you like, that strategy and that consultation. I think that's really important, the six of us are involved.
If not, I'll speak loudly. There we go. But yes, most certainly. Well, part of the soft market test. Just as part of that soft market testing, we've had it back from one of the consultancy firms that they would actually run a stakeholder consultation process as part of this. But I say we're already talking with the sailing club. But yes, absolutely, include councils. Yeah. Want to keep everybody briefed in, no surprises.
Thank you. Cottier first and then turning on.
Thank you, Chair. Fairly used to this, but how has the sand deposits been previously dealt with? Because obviously that happens every time the tide comes over, so there must have been a regime or a schedule. I just don't know, so could you tell me, please?
So the sand is deposited in the lake in two ways. So it does come in with the tide as a tidal borne sediment, but predominantly it's blown in by the wind into the lake. So there's two different methods that it can come in. The wind-blown sand becomes more prevalent as the beach levels in West Kirby get higher and higher with accretion. And so they are covered by the tide less often, they dry out more frequently, and they're more susceptible to being blown by the sand into the lake. So we're probably getting more wind-blown sand now than we have done historically. But to go back to your question, the way that the sand has been removed in the past has been to completely empty the lake of contaminated seawater and then to put trap machines and plant in there to excavate the sand and then to move it over the lake wall and then deposit it on the foreshore adjacent. In my knowledge, since about the mid-90s, that's been done three times.
Thank you. Well, can you rough idea of the cost then? Comparatively, inflation and so on. So that half a million isn't, or the half a million costed for that removal. That's comparatively in keeping with what's been done before.
You know, that figure is significantly more because the land-based operation is obviously the most efficient in terms of cost, especially the disposal of the sand. If the regulators don't allow us to enter the lake, because we'll allow the spread of the weed spores into the estuary, then we have to think of a waterborne operation which is necessarily more expensive. And if the regulators also won't allow us to deposit the sand onto the adjacent foreshore, it's got to be transported off site and to a licensed waste disposal site. So that's why the cost of that.
Thank you, Chair. Is there any other marine lake or any other similar facility that's got the same problem throughout the UK? I'm sure you've researched that. And on the environmental and climate indications, Dr. Geraldine Reed from the World Museum of Liverpool has been named as someone who can possibly identify. Can you just fill me in a little bit more on all that?
Yeah, one of the two companies that have visited us to do a soft market testing, they have referred to other marinas and lakes around the country. In fact, one of the companies is actually working with one of them now, and they're looking at different solutions to this. what's happened, you know, whether it's over in Crosby. That Crosby was the main one. I think they got a problem of their own, but there doesn't seem to be anything that we can grasp hold of to say they've got the same as we have, they've got the same conditions, and they've got the solution. That's why we're struggling at the moment. Sometimes it isn't great to be unique. You know, just want to be the same as everybody else and know what the solution is. One option came through yesterday, but I don't know how realistic it is. It's like an amphibious type craft, you know, like the duck that used to go into the Albert Dock in Liverpool, the yellow thing. So it's dry land, goes in, and then cruises up and down with some kind of rating.
That's sand on it.
They did. I know it's not a good omen, is it? But imagine something like that, except not yellow, that could deal with the weed.
Yeah.
It ain't cheap either. So, but this is where you need the proper people, the consultants, to, you know, recommend. So we have struggled to find a similar environment to ours that we can learn from. I can't remember the second bit of the question.
Dr. Geraldine Reed is named.
Yes. Yeah, I can't quite remember where that name came from, but I do know one of those soft market testers has been in touch with her, and she would be willing to be part of the, you know, identification process. So it's handy having, you know, an expert on the doorstep, for sure.
Thank you.
Okay. Mike? Yeah, thank you, Chair. We looked at, we've got three options here. The last option was the short-term fix. Now that was done in 2009. What sort of time, what life expectancy of the lake we went to the full hit? Would be, hopefully it'll be a lot more than 10 years, but do you have any idea of what sort of life expectancy you've got on it before we start to put more money into the lake?
My sort of understanding of this for this week is that it would need initially, say in 2020, the main clear.